either we're only going to see it partially. And this eclipse has been nicknamed the Great American Eclipse. So we ask ourselves, why is this the Great American Eclipse? We first might think, well, maybe eclipses are rare over America. Well, these are all the paths of eclipses over America, and they're certainly not unusual. But if you look, this is 1,000 years, you might say, well, maybe you don't get an eclipse too often. But here, in 1979, 38 years ago, there was a total eclipse right across the northwest of the United States, and partial eclipse over other parts of the United States. Even in 2024, we're going to have another eclipse over the United States, over the eastern part of the United States. So we kind of ask ourselves, why is this called the Great American Eclipse? Well, first of all, this is the first eclipse in almost 100 years that's gone from the west coast of the United States to the east coast, along the entire continent of the United States. And more important than that, it's the first total solar eclipse since 1257, that's 800 years ago, whose path of totality crosses the entire United States and is limited only to the United States. And you'll see why, what that's all about later. And in fact, the next such eclipse is going to be in 2316. So an eclipse like we're going to see next Monday happens about once every 500 years. So that's why it's called the Great American Eclipse. Now, well, let me try this just briefly. There have been very many famous eclipses. Eclipses are awesome devices and unusual, as I'll point out. And the first eclipse that was ever recorded that we know about was a record found on a tablet that was discovered in what is now Syria. And this tablet was written in about an eclipse that happened in 1374 BC. That's 3,300 years ago, 3,300 years ago, the first people ever to record an eclipse. And if you read there, that's how they recorded it. On the day of the new moon in the month of Haya, the sun was put to shame and went down in the daytime with Mars in attendance. And that was the first recording of a total eclipse. And the recording didn't say this eclipse happened in 1374 BC because they didn't have such dates in those days. But historians and archaeologists can determine the period at which this relic was used. And then astronomers can say, okay, in this place in Syria, at this time, when were the total eclipses? And they found a total eclipse that kind of matches this one. There are other famous eclipses like that. If you're really interested, you go online and you Google famous eclipses and you'll see dozens and dozens of eclipses related to the births and deaths of famous people, battles won and lost, anything you can imagine. As I say, going back to 1300 BC. Now, eclipses have also served science. And one of the famous eclipses in that regard has to do with the discovery of helium. Now helium, as you should know, is one of the elements that exists in the periodic table. Helium is the second most abundant element in the universe.
It's in balloons.
It's very, very rare on Earth. And helium was not discovered until someone observed an eclipse of the sun. And when he observed that eclipse of the sun, he saw a spectrum of light from the sun. And that orange line there is the spectral line of helium. So helium was discovered only through an eclipse, was never known of before. And in fact, helium is named after the Greek god of the sun, Helios. So that's how it gets its name.
Helium is what makes balloons float.
Helium is lighter than, helium is often what you put in balloons. It's lighter than air, And it's well, it's a rare gas. Now, the most famous eclipse of all, and I'll just try and mention it without too much detail, is the so-called Einstein eclipse. You all know about Einstein, right? Okay.
Yes.
Einstein developed a theory in 1915, about 100 years ago, that said that light could be deflected by mass. That means if I would shine a light past Lily, the light would bend. And people found that hard to believe, because the theory that existed before Einstein's theory was Newton's theory. Newton was a famous English physicist who didn't have the same kind of theoretical results. So Einstein said, I'll tell you how you can prove my theory. There will be a total eclipse of the sun. At a time of a total eclipse, I want you to look at the stars. Remember, when an eclipse is total, it's nighttime, even though it's daytime. I want you to look at the stars and see if you can measure any deflection of the stars from their known positions. And that's just what happened. This is the man's name was Sir Arthur Eddington. It's a very famous eclipse. This is the negative of the eclipse, so the moon looks white, and that's the chromosphere of the sun. That's what you see around the sun. You can only see it when it's eclipsed. And see these two lines over there? They measured stars, and they measured their positions. And just like on your GPS, you can measure your position, well, an astronomer can measure a position of the star exactly where it is. They measured positions of the stars over there, and then they compared the positions they measured with the positions when the sun was not there in a normal nighttime sky. Remember, there'll be a few days later, the sun will not be near these stars. And what they found, sure enough, was that light was deflected by the mass, the body of the sun. And the thing to remember about Einstein's theory of special relativity is that gravity kind of warps space-time. It makes it look kind of warpage in here. And instead of the light traveling straight as it would normally, when it gets to that warped area, it bends. And somebody on Earth, looking at the star, thinks it comes from where it says observed, but the star was really behind the sun. So in reality, the sun has bent the ray of light. This finding in 1919, May 29th, 1919, here was some pictures in the Illustrated News in London, and there's the headlines in the New York Times. These made Einstein just internationally famous. And in fact, his name became synonymous with genius. Before this time, he was very well known by the scientists, but not known by the people. And this event made him a household name, so to speak. Okay, so now let's talk about why do you have an eclipse? And some of you here know. You have an eclipse when the sun and the earth and the moon are in alignment. And this can only happen at the time of a new moon. Here is the moon orbiting the Earth. And when the moon is between the Earth and the sun, it's a new moon because the side opposite the Earth is illuminated by the sun and the other side is dark. And that's the new moon. And the new moon casts a shadow on the Earth. And if you look at the full shadow, it's called the umbra. And it also has a partial shadow, which we'll talk about in a minute, called the penumbra. So that's the situation that has to exist as the moon goes through its orbit. When it gets to this position, it will cause an eclipse. But that is not the only reason, that is not the special reason that you get an eclipse. Because there's one other thing that has to be true. And what has to be true is that this angle here, is the same for the sun and the moon. So when you look at the sun, you see something about this big. When you look at the moon, you see something about this big. So the moon and the sun, as we look at them from the Earth, even though the moon, the sun is very much farther away, is so much bigger that its size looks the same. And without that, you couldn't have an eclipse. And in fact, if you look, on average, they're almost exactly the same. It's about a half of a degree. That, as I said, if you hold a quarter, a nickel up to the sky, that's how round. But you see how big the moon looks? That's a half a degree in the sky. But here's the point. Because the Earth rotates around the sun in an elliptical orbit, which some of you may understand, meaning it isn't a nice smooth circle, and the moon orbits the Earth in an elliptical orbit, the apparent image of the sun and the moon change in size. So when the image of the moon, say 0.49, is smaller than the image of the sun, you don't completely cover the sun. And that's when you get an annular eclipse. When the size of the moon is greater than the size of the sun, that's when you get a total eclipse. So that's why you get different kinds of eclipses.
And tomorrow's is
tomorrow
what?
Is tomorrow. I'll tell you about tomorrow's in a minute. Tomorrow is a total eclipse. But yes. Now the interesting thing, if the moon was in a circular orbit instead of an elliptical orbit, and if the moon travels around the Earth, and you can think of a plane. Here's a plane that the moon is traveling around the Earth, and the Earth travels around the sun in another plane. If these planes were the same, we would get a total eclipse once every 29 and a half days. Once a month, we would have a total eclipse someplace on Earth. But it turns out the moon's orbit is inclined to the Earth's orbit. So most often the shadow of the moon misses the Earth. So at most we can get only about 2 to 5 eclipses a year, and you can only get 2 total eclipses a year someplace on Earth, on average. So what eclipses are, now what really makes eclipses rare are the fact, this is our Great American Eclipse, between these two blue lines, is where people will see a total eclipse. Between those lines is 70 miles. That's less than the distance from here to Fort Lauderdale. The only people in the world who will see a total eclipse tomorrow are the people who are within these two lines. So you can see that's why eclipses are rare for people to see them. In fact, that's why you often have exhibitions to go see an eclipse, because it covers a very small part of the Earth. Now, eclipses are rare for another reason. You all know when you look at a globe that the Earth is mostly covered by water. 70% of the Earth's surface is oceans and seas, and only 30% is land. And the land is not called inhabited. Only about 40% of the land is inhabited. So even if an eclipse were to occur any place on the globe, inhabitants of the Earth would only see about 1 in 8. So we don't even live in places where we can see every eclipse. And you can see this here. Just look at the blue lines. The blue lines are the paths of total eclipses for a period of 20 years. And notice that mostly these paths are over water, and how little of these paths are over land. Like this is our eclipse that we're seeing tomorrow. So mostly, you have to go to a special location to see an eclipse, and that's what makes eclipses so rare. Now let's talk about what we see in water. On your right is the total eclipse. That's what happens when the moon's image is bigger than the sun's image, so the moon completely obscures the sun, and you have a total eclipse. when the moon's image is left.